Hey guys, how's it going? It's Sean. The goal of this video is to see and compare people from all around the world and how much they trust the government in their countries. In the United States, for example, a lot of Americans are very skeptical and do not trust the government. I'm speaking in terms of privacy, transparency, and censorship. I'm so curious to see what people from all around the world will say about this in terms of their country. All right then, let's begin. Hello, sir.
Hello, how are you?
Hi, where are you from?
The US.
I'm from Czech Republic.
I'm from France.
I'm from the US.
Sweden.
All right. Yay. Yay. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you trust the government in your home country?
3.
In the US, maybe 7. There are some things I trust them on. Things that I don't.
Fair 6, 7.
Okay.
I don't know, depends on the person. We're pretty corrupt.
I mean a 10.
Yeah, a 10, yeah.
9 or 10, like
nine
in the
ten,
top
yeah.
numbers,
yeah. Oh really? So they really respect people's privacy?
Yeah. They do, yeah.
Oh wow.
Maybe 2?
Oh, you don't trust the US government?
I don't
government.
Trust them at all. 1. I'll give it a 1.
Oh, okay.
The government really only has corporations in mind. I don't believe that they listen to the general public.
People would be happy with the government in the US if the government was doing what they wanted. How can you be upset with someone who's doing what you asked them to do? But people are upset with the government, which sort of implies that something with our democracy is broken. Either we don't know what we want, which to some degree is possible.
Very much possible.
Or it just means the government's obstinately going against our wishes, which I think is more likely.
Would you say most French people trust the French government?
I think the majority would be saying no. I'm not really French, I'm Italian and living in France, so...
What about the Italian government?
The Italian government is a little bit messy, I'd rather say, and it's maybe worse in Italy. They don't really trust the government. I think they just don't like politics, and I think they if they can just avoid politics, they don't just do it.
So obviously you have multiple politicians, so like some of them I trust, some of them I don't, so it's like depends on the politician in question, you know.
I give a couple points to the Supreme Court. That seems like a pretty solid system. In terms of the president and just the way Congress works, I give like 1 or 0.
Okay. Privacy, do you think the government respects your privacy?
I would say they do.
Okay.
But again, on a scale of 1 to 10, like average 5.
To a certain degree. Okay. I think they do a decent job compared to some other countries, so.
Fair enough. Yes. They really respect people's privacy.
Yeah. They do, yeah.
Yeah. They do.
Oh, wow.
We would never have like CCTV cameras in Sweden.
There are CCTVs in like grocery stores and of course like in
private
like,
institutions.
Yeah, and people have it like in their homes. It's really popular to have these security systems, you know.
But not the government. Yeah. That's that's the individual's choice.
Exactly.
Yeah. Wow, that's really cool.
Yeah.
Transparency.
That one's a little more difficult, I think, because it really depends on what they're talking about, how transparent they are. So.
Censoring.
It's not a thing. We're able to have, you know, all these Google and
we get all information available. So, yeah. I mean, it's a 10.
Recently, way too much on the, like, especially certain subjects that are, like, hot political topics right now. They're cracking down on certain people groups and then letting others say whatever the heck they want.
It's almost like it's even like you get almost too much information about people. You know, you can look up, like, you can use Google. You know, what people's income is, where people have, like, you know,
where they live.
Do they have 2 cars? And if they look at like my address, my name, like they can see my address, who people I live with, how many cars we have at our place.
Yeah. But different. I think that you can also choose to not have those.
Yeah, you can choose
that information available.
Oh,
but
that's
many
good.
People
that's very good.
Have it because of I don't know. It's really
they don't
just
even know like how to look how to change it. And
first thing that comes to my mind is what if you're some kind of famous person, you're a celebrity, and you're popular, and you have some weird people stalking you.
Yeah.
I'm sure you would want to not put that information online publicly. You would want to make it private.
But those kind of people, they make it like, you know.
Yeah.
And so that's the citizen's choice.
Yeah,
it is.
This is so fascinating.
Yeah, but it's also very different. We don't have like paparazzi. in Sweden, and it's very normal.
It's not. It's totally different than
it's
in the US.
It's very normal for a famous person to just walk down the street and no one cares.
Yeah.
Like.
Wow. Would you say you're representative of the average American and how much do they trust their government?
I think the average American trusts the government around a 4 or 5. The more critical Americans, me included, are lower than that.
Yeah.
And I think the oblivious Americans, who ironically hate the government, they trust the government the most.
People are very supportive of the government.
Yep.
Or very against it, okay. Or don't have any opinion whatsoever.
Mm. It's usually the older generations that really trust the government.
Yeah.
Younger generations, not so much.
There are some people who are very expressive of their lack of trust in the government. More of the people of minorities, the people of color, the queer communities. They don't trust the government because they are actively hurt by it.
Uh-huh.
They don't have a faith in the system because the system is built against them.
Uh-huh.
So I agree with that stance more.
You have multiple groups of people, like people that trust the government more, people that trust the government less.
Yeah.
Usually depends on age, other demographics as well, income. Not everyone is the same. You have individuals, right?
Yeah.
So it's hard to generalize like that.
What do you think the citizens' responsibility is in terms of a government keeping them in check if they don't agree with them?
Well, our responsibility, first and foremost, as human beings, we should as peacefully as possible make changes to things we don't like. And the way we do that in the modern day is we vote people in and out. But nowadays, people don't even trust those systems. They don't trust their own democracy that votes count. And a lot of positions are actually not voted in, they're appointed in. So there's definitely some loopholes in the system. And then I also think it's our civic duty when we say, hey, here's the change we want. The majority want this, but you're not doing it. Then it's our civic duty to protest. But of course, protest also has many different vectors in terms of peacefulness and what is ethically okay in terms of how a protest ought to go down.
How satisfied are you and trusting of your government's handling of the pandemic?
Everyone has a different opinion.
Yeah.
Of what they think that our government can do better and have done very good.
In terms of
transparency in the pandemic, they are very transparent about it, and they do state, like, if we maybe did something wrong, they are very, like, truthful with that. They can't have, like, a mandatory law
quarantine
or something
because vaccinations.
It's not mandatory,
Not mandatory.
Very interesting.
But we have been very criticized for how the government handles the pandemic in Sweden.
Uh-huh. Sure.
Yeah. Like the US.
Yeah.
Sounds like you guys are very
we have a lot of freedom
relaxed
and relaxed
about it. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. Did you enjoy this video? Let me know in the comments down below. I will see you guys in the next video. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, everyone.
열심히 영어 공부를 하시는 분이라면 Serious Learners 멤버십에 가입해보세요. 여러 가지 레벨이 있는데 멤버십 혜택 중에는 한영 대본, 한영을 자유롭게 설정할 수 있는 영상 그리고 영어 발음을 위한 쉐도잉 시리즈도 있습니다. 관심 있으시면 아래 설명 참고해주세요. Good! So how have I changed after living in Korea for over 7 years? Well, when thinking about this, I thought to myself, what do humans want? What are our goals in life? I think we're all pretty similar in that pretty much everyone wants to be financially stable. They want to find a good romantic partner. They want to be in good health. And they want a community of people around them that understand them and that support them. So how has Korea impacted this life goal? Well, to start it off, I think I've accomplished some pretty cool things while living here. I have created a YouTube channel that has over 300,000 subscribers. I've created an amazing mastermind business group where me and other small business owners meet online a few times a month to discuss our own businesses and to give each other advice. I've learned Korean reasonably fluently. 저는 이제 일상생활에서 문제 없이 하고 싶은 걸 다 할 수 있어요. 병원에 가든가, 뭐 마트에 가서 뭐 필요한 거를 사든가 아니면 영어를 잘 못하는 친구들과 소통할 수 있어요. 그리고 비즈니스 할 때도 한국어로 진행할 때가 많아요. 제 생각에는 대부분 외국인들보다 제가 한국어 공부하는 곳에 시간을 더 많이 투자한 것 같아요. The reason I'm bringing this up, though, is not to brag. It's to say that when I was living in my hometown in Philadelphia, I wasn't as ambitious as I am now after living in Seoul for 7 years. I think a lot of people from small towns and small cities can relate when they say that growing up, the people around them were kind of just content with life. And there's nothing wrong with that. But living in Seoul, living in this big city, maybe New York, maybe Tokyo are similar, you really absorb the energy around you and it makes you want to accomplish bigger goals and associate with people who are also really driven and ambitious. And now I can't really imagine life without having smaller or bigger goals to accomplish. So Korea has also changed me because I came here alone. So I had to force myself to make new friends, step outside my comfort zone, and in many cases, I had to force myself to speak Korean in order to even just talk to people. At the end of the day, it's really made me think, life is too short to be shy. You never know when some kind of connection or some kind of friendship is going to help you in some way. I've met so many other digital nomads here, hanging out and talking to some of the brightest minds in Korea, both foreign and Korean, and now I have some of the best friends I've ever had in my life. As many of you know, I'm really interested in cryptocurrency and NFTs, and I've met some amazing Koreans here who are also interested in NFTs and cryptocurrency. And I think things like these are only possible in really big cities like Seoul. By the way, if you guys don't know yet, I have a cryptocurrency channel. I talk all about cryptocurrency for beginners, and I make it interesting, so definitely check it out if you haven't already. Links down below. So another way that living in Korea has changed me is I've been able to teach a lot of amazing kids because I was an English teacher for 4 years. Being a teacher, I've grown to really appreciate the amazing energy that kids have and their outlook on life. They're always in the moment and they give you the same energy that you give them. I always noticed that teaching kids was a lot easier than teaching adults because, you know, adults would work during the day, then come to the academy I was teaching at in the evening and they'd be exhausted. So I would have to give them all of my energy, teaching them, you know, motivating them to speak English, and then I would be exhausted afterwards. Whereas teaching kids, it's more like, you know, hey guys, let's have fun. And they're like, yeah, let's have fun. I'm like, cool. I've stopped teaching now maybe 3 to 4 years ago, but I really miss it from time to time. And I could definitely say if I had never come to Korea, I wouldn't have had that opportunity and I wouldn't have learned that I really do enjoy working with kids. Next thing that's changed for me in Korea is when I came here, I was kind of like a big boy. I wasn't very mature and I wasn't very good with romantic relationships. But I've met some amazing people here, friends and romantic partners, and now I've been with my girlfriend for 2 years, and she's just amazing. I'm so grateful to have met her, and we're really supporting each other in our personal development, becoming stronger people. And I think this is like one of the healthiest, best relationships I have in my life right now. I feel so lucky to have met a woman like that here. So going along with that, I think I've matured a lot in general. Just being here in Korea. My interests have changed and I've really improved my lifestyle and my diet. I cook a lot more and I try to eat very healthily and I work out a lot at the gym. Maybe that's just me being older and me being more responsible with my habits. But I think in general, just being in Seoul and being in Korea, there's this constantly, you know, have to get better kind of mentality. And that's really had a positive impact on me. However, I can imagine that this can be maybe stressful for some people. Always feeling pressured by those around them to do more, to work harder. It's not for everybody. And I can imagine myself wanting to get away from this environment as I get older. I find it interesting to compare to Seoul with Chungju. So I lived in Chungju, Chungcheongdo, for 1 year. And my lifestyle there was so different than it is here in Seoul. Like I keep saying, Seoul is a massive, big city. And there's such good positive energy here, such motivated people, like that Pali Pali Munhwa. But in Chungju, I really remember it being very slow, relaxed, walking down these big streets, listening to music, seeing more nature, more scenic views. I could imagine if I were to live somewhere like Jeju or somewhere in more rural, that I might have a different outlook on life compared to the outlook I have now. So in conclusion, living here in Seoul, South Korea has changed me for the better in so many ways. I'm so grateful. I'm not really sure exactly how long I'll live here because nobody knows the future. But up until this point, It's been amazing. I've met amazing people and I've really improved my life in so many ways. And I'm eternally grateful. So I hope you guys really enjoyed this video. Let me know if you like videos like this in the comment section down below. By the way, if you're currently studying English, definitely consider subscribing to my channel membership. I will see you in the next video. Bye. Hey guys, how's it going? It's Sean. Many of you don't know this, but I'm actually a huge fan of scary movies and scary stories. So today I have a big treat for you guys. Natural English listening through a scary story. Now, without further ado, let's begin. My fiancé and I are from California, but her family lives in Colorado, and they own a cabin near Pikes Peak, way up in the mountains. After visiting them, they recommended we stay at the cabin a few days. We are avid hikers, and we jumped at the opportunity. Colorado is very rich in Native American folk legend. Virtually every place you go used to belong to an indigenous community, and the few of them who remain keep the traditions and stories alive. Pikes Peak is no different. There are enough stories to give anybody the sense that the land itself is alive. Perhaps that has something to do with what is happening to us. Faye and I are currently at the cabin. It's day 4 and we were planning on leaving today, but things have gotten very strange around here and it looks like we're going to be here for a while longer. We have enough food for a winter and the heater is in stellar order, but the Wi-Fi is terrible and there is virtually no cell phone reception. We feel isolated. I'm writing this all now to give you an update on what's happening to us, and I will post it online when the Wi-Fi is working. The first weird thing that happened was the snow. There was no snow in the forecast, so we packed light. But on our first night here, just our luck, a blizzard pounded the whole area. My little Corolla vehicle is basically a brick of ice outside, and there's no way I'm going to try to make the 6-mile drive down the mountain to the town. I can only blame myself for trusting Colorado in the spring. After a day, Thursday, of lovely hiking and sightseeing, some really unsettling stuff started happening. We returned to the cabin just before dusk. We found an enormous dreamcatcher dangling from a tree about a dozen yards from the back door. This wasn't the kind you're imagining, the kind you buy from a novelty shop. This was made from twigs and twine, and it's about 3 feet in diameter. Absolutely humongous. Neither Faye nor I were stupid enough to touch it. We're veteran horror movie fans, and we know that's how you get cursed. That night, while we were eating dinner, we heard a bunch of noises in the woods outside. Twigs crunching, leaves rustling. This isn't unusual, because we saw some elk and deer on our hike. But the sounds were slow and purposeful. They stopped and started and were rhythmic, like someone was circling our cabin. I used my really bright tactical flashlight to look outside from the porch, but there was nothing. We stayed in all day on Friday and just cuddled, hung out, played some of the board games we brought, and some of the Super Nintendo games we had in the cabin. In particular, Donkey Kong Country 2, which I have considered stealing because it's the greatest game ever made. It snowed again, and after dark, we started hearing some more noises. Around 1 a.m., Faye woke me up and told me she was hearing a voice outside. I strained to listen, and I thought I could make out the sound of a man crying very far away, but his voice was drowned out by the wind, so I wasn't absolutely certain of what I heard. We went back to sleep, but again, around 4:45 a.m., we heard him more distinctly and closer. He sounded like he was calling for help, but he would dip into another language that I've never heard before.
Help. Help.
We called the ranger station at the bottom of the hill using my cell phone, and they told us they'd get up there and check it out. But we never saw them, and I doubt they ever came. On Saturday, shit got really scary. It snowed again in the morning, and I stopped getting service for most of the day. Faye and I watched movies and tried to Skype with her family, but that didn't work. She went to sleep early, around 8, while I did some photo editing on my laptop in the living room. She woke up crying hysterically. When I asked her what was wrong, she said she'd had a dream that she was lost in the woods outside and something was following her. I cuddled with her until she fell back asleep, and eventually, I drifted off too. Faye woke me up around 1 a.m. She was absolutely beside herself. I've never seen her so afraid in my life, and just the look on her face really unsettled me. She told me that she heard the man outside again, but she recognized the voice. She was absolutely convinced that it was her grandfather's voice, and that he was wandering around outside begging for help. Faye's grandfather died when we were seniors in college, 4 years ago. I told her that she was dreaming, but then I heard the voice too.
Help me! Help me, please! Please help me!
I never met the guy, so I wouldn't recognize his voice, but it did sound different from the night before. It sounded older. I had to do everything I could to keep her from running off into the woods looking for him. Eventually, she realized that the possibility of it being him was absurd, so we put a movie on at a good volume and fell back asleep. My cell phone wouldn't connect a single call. What happened last night, Sunday, was the thing that has sent me over the edge. Essentially, the same thing happened. Around 1 a.m., at which point I was still awake, almost expecting the noise to happen, I heard the voice. This time, it was a woman's. Thankfully, it was distant enough that it didn't wake Faye. I walked into the bathroom and cracked the window open just a tiny bit. The frosty air that came through that crack seemed like a death sentence to me as a Californian. Nobody could survive outside for that long in that kind of weather. Not without serious, military-grade winter gear. And yet, someone was wandering around out there, stepping on twigs and crying? Now, I'm a reasonable person, sometimes even skeptical, but I'm telling you, the voice sounded exactly like my mother's.
Help me!
My mom is alive and well and living in Southern California, so when I heard my mother's voice out here in the Rocky Mountains, I knew something was really wrong. I would know my mother's voice anywhere. I think we all would. And I am telling you, I'm about 90% sure it was hers, which is way too sure to not scare the living shit out of me. I grabbed my light and went outside with a blanket wrapped around me and my hiking boots on. There were tracks in the snow as if someone was drunkenly shuffling around. Maybe they were injured. The path went right up to the bathroom window and then back into the woods.
Help me!
Each time the voice called out, I shouted, "Mom?" or "Who's there?" or "Who are you?" And each time the voice receded further into the woods. I'm pretty sure it was trying to coax me deeper and deeper into the forest, away from the cabin. I'm still alive now because I'm not an idiot. I'm not gonna die like some moron in a bad horror movie. I went back inside and made sure we were locked down tight. Since I'm not able to call the ranger station, I'm posting this instead, and I will upload it to you guys when the Wi-Fi comes back on. It is now 9:30 p.m. on Monday. I've been able to get online twice today. I wish I knew more about electronics, but I'm a history teacher, so I don't think I can fix the Wi-Fi or predict when it'll work. Faye hasn't been feeling well since noon. She developed a stomach ache and has been intermittently throwing up. We both ate the same thing and I feel fine, so I'm not sure what it is. She sometimes gets like this when she gets worked up. Although I'm an atheist, she's very Catholic and is pretty convinced that something supernatural is going on. No need for alarm at the moment. She does not have a fever and I'm keeping her hydrated and in high spirits. It seems like she's getting a little bit better and she went to sleep about an hour and a half ago. Some more noises to report. Cackling. repetitive vocalizations in the forest, probably 100 yards out. The tree line starts about 20 yards out, so this sound is coming from much deeper. Some movement spotted just behind the tree line at dusk, but it could be elk or deer. I couldn't really see very much. Keeping all the curtains closed, windows locked, furniture in front of the front door and back door, and I'm checking on Faye every half hour. Her dad will be here in the late morning to pick us up and dig my car out. If anything else significant happens, I promise I will update you guys. Hey there, my name is Navajo Joe, and my ancestors are Navajo Native Americans. I saw your post. Although we're not in or from Colorado, it sounds like you're dealing with a chindi, or an evil spirit. You were smart not to take down the dreamcatcher. That and the snow are blessings from someone or something protecting you from the chindi. Dreamcatchers are very powerful tools used not just for dreams. They are meant to filter out the evil while allowing the good to flow through. The fact that the chindi stays out of the boundary shows the dreamcatcher is working. Now, the snow. It might seem like a bad thing, but think about it. The snow is keeping you guys indoors at night when this stuff is happening. You are not wandering out for a midnight hike and second guessing going out to investigate too much. There are probably some old gods watching over you and protecting you. Next, your girl with the stomach problems. If you can find some local Native American medicine, get it. Normally, I would tell you to make some sage tea, but I'm not sure if there is any where you're at. Ingesting corn pollen or even a little natural tobacco could also help. You don't want the chindi following you home. Finally, chindi are evil spirits that will try to infect your life to feed off your misery and fear. Don't go outside or open the windows anymore. I cannot stress this enough. You're very lucky that that dream catcher was up and keeping it away. If you go outside again when it's calling, you run the risk of it coming in. Stay inside, close all the windows and doors, and ignore this bastard till morning. All right, good luck. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. Once again, I'm Sean. If you enjoyed this video, please let me know in the comment section down below, and maybe I'll make more of them in the future. Anyway, I will see you guys in the next video. Bye.
Your best impression of Korean right now?
Especially when they eat, they're like, yeah, yeah, 이거, 이거, 맞아, 아, 야. Oh, 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 I go, I go, I go.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Aish.
Oh, really? Ah, 그렇구나, yeah. 아, 진짜. Yeah. Where are you guys from again?
Seattle.
Seattle.
And how long have you been in Korea?
I've been here for a year, about
3 weeks.
Just got out of quarantine. Far. Okay, all right. As people who don't speak Korean, what does Korean sound like? How can you express it in words?
I feel like, based on my experience, because it's based on what situation you're in, because like, if you're next to taxi drivers, very rough sounding.
Taxi drivers?
Yes.
Yeah, they sound very aggressive.
Yeah, they're very aggressive. The one thing I do realize that, especially for girls, they tend to end the sentence or words in a drawn out cutesy way.
Oh.
You know, I always say like, oh, 감사합니다, or something like that, like, 안녕하세요.
Are you talking like people work at the cash register? Like?
Cash registers, or even when I just hear them talking, yeah, on the street, yeah. There's like that cutesy
the
way of talk.
It flows out, you know?
Yeah, it flows out, but it sounds so cute. Like, I'm pretty sure, like, the language itself doesn't sound like that naturally.
I don't know, it just sounds so nice. Like, I don't know, curvy. Like, curvy. I don't know how to describe it.
That's what I've heard.
Yeah, like, it flows out just amazingly. Like, that's the best way I can put it. Like, it's just bubbly, like I said.
How about some, you know, key expressions like, even if you guys can't understand 100%, like, for example, you're walking on the street and you hear some people having a conversation, but, oh, I understood that, or like, oh, I can catch a bit of that. What, is there any words or expressions like that?
More, rather than words, it's the sound effects that they make. Yeah. It's the sound effects that they make. One of them is like, aish. Everywhere I go, aish, aish. Or especially when they eat, they're like, yeah, yeah, 이거, 이거, 맞아, 아, 야. Just little sound effects that they make. They always go like, ah, 이거, 이거 아니지.
이거 아니지.
Just little things like that. Yeah, yeah.
Your pronunciation is very good.
Oh, thank you. I try my best. Yeah, it's like they like the little terms, but they always add little sound effects to it. So it makes it really fun.
It has its own intonation, you know?
Yeah, yeah, it does.
Of course, yeah. How about you? What can you understand while you're walking on the street?
As soon as I got out of quarantine, like I got off the shuttle bus at Incheon bus terminal, and like two cab drivers, they're like one cut off the other.
Oh,
he got out of his car.
He got his
the first thing I heard was, Aish. So I was like, oh. It was hilarious.
You know, whenever you learn another language, you always learn from cuss words.
Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. I just always say it now.
Yeah. Where are you from?
I'm Russian. My name is Maria.
And how long have you been in Korea again?
Around approximately 8 years.
What does the Korean language sound like to a foreigner?
Like, at first when I heard it, it sounded like somebody was chewing rocks and spitting in a different way. Like, as a Russian, but like in a cute way. Because like Russians, I know that sounds aggressive to people.
Yeah.
And English was like a very musical language to me.
Yeah.
But Korean was completely different ones because I've never heard like a language like that. Yeah. Even when Korean people like swear or something, I don't feel like it's aggressive. Yeah, it's still just like adorable even.
You know,
very emotional.
Can you do your best impression of Korean right now?
안녕하세요. 제가 러시아에서 오는 마리엔입니다.
So like, whenever I speak Korean, my voice goes like 3 levels upwards.
아, 제가 술집 갔는데 술 마셨어요.
So you're trilingual, I assume.
Two and a half.
We just call it 2.5. Yeah.
I like Korean, but it's just still learning. It's still getting there, yeah. Kind of.
It's a very hard language to learn.
It's not, but it's the structure is different, especially from Russian.
Where are you guys from again?
I'm from Germany.
And I'm from Poland.
And how long have you guys been in Korea so far?
2 weeks in quarantine and like 1.5 weeks out of it.
And I assume you're the same?
Yeah.
All right. What does the Korean language sound like to you guys?
Well, for me, sometimes it sounds a little harsh, like especially when it gets kind of louder.
Louder.
But in general, it sounds really like musical. Yeah, yeah, musical.
You got a musical, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's like really fast, I think.
Yeah.
And it's like, something like this, you know? Just really fast and...
Okay, yeah. Yeah, give me your best impression about Korean.
People or Korean language. It just 안녕하세요 all the time, and I think like every word is like the same, like the 안녕하세요 and 감사합니다, and everything sounds the same.
Oh,
yeah,
really, a lot of similar sounds in the language.
Many.
Yeah,
but in general, Korean is also a lot of mumbling for me. Like
that's true. That's that. Yeah, that's true.
There's a lot of people who say that, yo, I can't distinguish Chinese from Japanese or Japanese from Korean.
I can distinguish the Korean language and the Japanese language, because Japanese is like more hard, yeah,
like that.
Yeah, something like that. And Korean is like smooth, yeah, it's smoother.
Okay,
yeah. But Chinese and Korean, I cannot
really, yeah, can distinguish. How about here?
I can hear no difference.
Not at all. Where are you from again?
I'm from Hawaii originally, but I've lived a long time in Oregon, so the US.
All right, and how long have you been in Korea so far?
I've been here since August, so 6 months.
6 months, okay.
It kind of sounds like soft to me, except for there's like a lot of like kind of sound, right?
So like, how's your Korean?
I know a bit, but like, I'm not great.
What are some catchphrases that you can pick up from listening to other people's conversations?
I hear like some swear words, of course.
It wasn't swear words, what?
Like, things like that, right? But, you know, like, you just hear a lot of like, oh, 안녕하세요, or a lot of greetings and things.
A lot
like
of greetings.
Oh, I go.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
That's the cutest one. A lot of older Koreans come up to me, and they're the sweetest. They're always just like, 어디에서 왔어요? Like, where are you from? And they're like,
of course, of course.
Oh, where do you go to school? You know, they're just very sweet, and they give me candy.
Really?
Yeah, I could probably fill a bowl now with the amount of candy that old Korean people have given me. Yeah. They're just the sweetest, kindest people.
My goodness.
Yeah. The Korean language is difficult. Yeah, like, difficult. There's a lot of similar sounding words.
Really? Yeah.
And if your pronunciation is off, it can sometimes like make things sound like you're saying a slang word. Yeah. And I found that out like with like my boyfriend is Korean, uh-huh. and so he's like, you should definitely work on the way that you say jotgarak, and I'm like, oh, okay, okay.
Ah, jotgarak. Yeah. Where are you guys from again?
Italy.
Italy.
Italy. All right. And how long have you guys been in Korea? You said.
Two weeks in quarantine.
2 weeks in quarantine?
Very yes.
Sad. Oh, so you just got out?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, first day.
Thank goodness.
I really like it because it's like really musical. Mm-hmm. Yeah. A language so poetic.
Really?
I really love it.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. There's a flow to it. Yeah.
Yeah. It's very like you express your feelings so well with the language. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I feel like you are Italians because we Italians talk so loudly and so expressively.
I've heard from a lot of people that it's aggressive, you know?
Yeah, for taxi drivers. They're crazy.
Like, what do they say to you guys? What do they say?
I don't know. They shout bad words.
Bad words.
Can we say it?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Just less.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
There are some nice taxi drivers.
Nice taxi drivers. I see. So how does it compare to other languages, do you think?
Well, their languages, Chinese, Japanese, and Korean, they're totally different to the year. Yeah. That's totally different. Because, like, we study Korean, so we have, like, our teacher that's from here, so we hear a lot of Korean. So, for me, it's very different.
I think that the problem is there is no information about Asia at all, especially in Europe. We don't study Asia at all,
really?
Even in high school yet. That's the problem. For example, the Korean War. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, mm-hmm. nobody knows about anything.
Maybe American people they know because they fought it. But us in Europe, we totally don't know about that.
Existed. Some people ask me if I was going to the south or the north.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my god.
I get that
god.
Question all the time too, yeah.
That's crazy for me.
Yeah, would I go to the north? What are you talking about?
Yeah.
Where are you guys from?
I'm from Jakarta and from Miami.
And how long have you been in Korea so far?
About eight months.
8 months so far attending school.
I think like the ajushis, like the old Korean men can sound a little like harsh and rude, but the sweet like Korean like young girls, like it sounds really sweet and soft.
Yeah. It sounds like musical because of the intonations in certain phrases and things like that. And also depending on who speaks and where you are in the country, it sounds different. So like here, it's like 표준어, like normal.
표준어.
Yeah.
How does Korean compare to some of the other languages in the world? How does it sound like?
Well, I speak French. Yeah. So compared to French, you know, the sounds, I guess, could be a bit more flowy, if that makes
flowy.
Any sense.
Yeah, flowy. Yeah, yeah.
Like it flows a lot.
흐름 있어, 흐름.
Yeah, like the words kind of have a, like a poetic sound to them when
like
you speak fully.
Almost.
Yeah.
Okay.
Really? I feel like it's more like, cause it's Korean characters, right? So the way you say it, it's like for example, like iced Americano, it's like ice Americano. It's like kind of separated. It sounds very soft, like ice Americano 하나 주세요, like that, you know?
Aren't you just saying it softly?
But I always say softly to like waiters and I'm not like
ice Americano.
Yeah, I'm not like. Yeah, because there's always like that hierarchy as well.
Yeah.
So you always have to sound like very polite. So unless.
Of course. Yeah, 촌댓말.
Yeah, 촌댓말. So like with like younger people, I feel like it sounds more soft. But like when elderlies like get mad at you, it's like kind of aggressive.
Aggressive. They want to kill you. Yeah.
Yeah. It's very scary. Yeah.
If you guys can speak Korean, what are some like typical catchphrases? Like even if you're like walking by the street and you hear people talking in Korean, if you can't understand it completely, you could understand a portion of it. What are some catchphrases like that, Mo?
Swear words.
Swear words?
Like, Oh, like 언니, 오빠.
A lot of the time when I hear like girls talking, yeah. they're always like, oh, 진짜?
Oh,
like
진짜?
All the time.
Oh, yeah, I always say that. Or
always,
네.
always, always. Like response words.
response words.
Yeah.
진짜? 아, 그렇구나.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Where are you from?
France.
And how long have you been in Korea so far?
It's been 4 years now.
4 years, all right. And so as a foreigner who lives here in Korea, how does the Korean language sound to you?
Not aggressive, a bit musical, I would say.
Musical, okay.
At first, it was a bit weird, mm-hmm. but then I get a bit used to it, and it's like more musical than really musical. Strong.
Does it have like a flow to it, you know?
Yeah.
What are some catchphrases that you think Koreans say a lot?
I don't know, like there is like something they will say always when they agree, it's like, ah, 그렇군요.
Ah, 그렇군요.
It's like something I...
Ah, 그렇군요.
Yeah, like, ah, 그렇군요. Ah, 진짜.
As a kind of flow to it.
Yeah.
Where are you from?
California.
And how long have you been in Korea so far?
This is my third year in Korea.
3 years. Oh my goodness.
I guess I would say it's a strong language.
A
yeah.
strong language.
Yeah, it sounds more harsh.
Yeah. Aggressive?
I guess you could say aggressive, but like pungent.
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 Very interesting expression.
Yes.
Is there some like basic expressions or like catchphrases you can understand?
Oh, very just like 잠시만요.
잠시만요.
Yeah, or just when people call out to each other.
Call out to each other.
Yeah.
All right, I see. How does it compare to other languages in the world?
Oh, I don't know. I guess when I think of Japanese, I feel like it's more
like
it
stops. It goes inside.
Yeah. Yeah, if that makes sense. Yeah, more. Okay. And I feel like Korean is more like
smooth,
and it's like yeah,
has a rhythm to it.
Yeah,
I see.
Yeah,
I see.
But I don't know any Japanese. The only thing I feel like I've picked up from Korean is just responding more to people like yeah, even in English when I'm talking to someone, I feel like I need to acknowledge them a lot more often.
Yeah, in Korean, like oh, 그렇구나. There's a lot of people who speak like that. So me naturally, when I'm talking with my friends from America on the phone, along the
Yes, I notice I do that a lot here, even in English. So
yeah, it's a good habit, you know. You're listening to what the other person has to say.
Yeah, exactly.
So my major in college was actually global study with a minor in East Asian studies. One of my favorite history tale or whatever is just the creation of the Korean written language.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah, it was like, it's like the only language that has been scientifically created.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I think like it was literally, it was literally made so that like people can learn it in like 2 hours.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that's super cool for a language. It's a great story, and it's a good, like, easy language to learn how to read.
You guys like your time here in Korea so far?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, it could be better. I've been here before without
without
Corona, so I know how it can be, but right now, better than other parts of the world.
I love it here so far.
Yeah.
Good. All right, thank you guys. You thumbs up here. So in general, like if like a Korean goes to Italy and they walk around, will people say ni hao or konnichiwa to them?
Yeah, really? That's totally racist.
The stereotypes,
I hate it.
The stereotypes.
Mm. Yeah.
The fact that Asians are all the same, for example, that's not true. I mean, I can recognize Chinese people from
my clothes.
Clothes,
yeah,
but
clothes,
even
Korean people dress so nice.
Yeah,
I love it.
I really think it's nice how they join words to create another word, like snowflake. Nunkot.
Nunkot.
I really love this kind of thing, so that's really fascinating to me.
Cool grammar, you know.
Yeah.
So you guys love your time here in Korea so far?
Of course. Of course.
Thank you for coming out today. Give a thumbs up. Thank you for coming out and sharing your opinion today. Yep, your thumbs up here. Thank you. Your thumbs up.
Your thumbs up?
Yep. 딱 엄지척 부탁드릴게요. 감사합니다.
How's it going? It's Sean from the US. So we're here in Yeonnam-dong, and I'm going to take you to a few places. First is my favorite yogurt place. It's such a delicious, healthy snack. We're going to go there first, eat some yogurt. Next, we're going to go to a really cool cafe that I like. It's got a crazy interior. Then we're just going to hang out here in the park, and we're going to discuss three interesting topics. The first is unexpected things I experienced when dating a Korean. The second one is trends that are becoming more and more socially acceptable all around the world. And the third is simply my favorite season here in Korea. And again, I'm joined here with my lovely girlfriend who is my camera woman. Oh my God, yes, she's the best. Hi guys, there she is in her nice pink jacket. So stylish. Oh my God. All right, so let's get started and let's go to my favorite yogurt place. Let's go. Hey guys, so we're in one of my favorite yogurt places here in Yeonnam-dong, and they make organic Greek yogurt. It's a family-run business. Very interesting and beautiful interior. It's like 1940s, very retro vintage style. I love coming here. And the yogurt is delicious. You guys are going to see in just a minute when it comes out. Wow, look at that beautiful yogurt. It's come out. So it's just regular Greek yogurt, slightly sweetened. And they have peanut butter, they have blueberries, grapes. There's some pomegranates on there with a few almonds and jelly on the side. So it's like, you know, you could argue that there's a bit of sugar in this, but it's pretty dang healthy, wouldn't you say? Kind of healthy, right? Not bad. All right, let's try it. All right, I'm gonna go first here. I'll be the guinea pig, the sacrificial lamb, and I will try this. Well, look at these nice spoons. Okay, so you gotta get a little bit of the peanut butter with some of the yogurt, some berries in there. Pomegranate, I'll get that later. Got the seed, you don't want to mix that. Some grapes here. Let's get a bite of that, huh? That is awesome. It's still good. We gotta get Yujung to try some of this. All right, ready? It's your turn, okay? You have to try it now. You gotta get one grape, one piece of peanut butter. Here we go. Oh, you like the peanut butter. How is it? Nice. Myeongjam. Oh, we got a winner here, ladies and gentlemen. We got a winner. All right, let's enjoy the yogurt. We're really putting in some work here, doing some damage on this yogurt. Can we finish this? You think so? Yeah, easy, right? No problem. So the first thing I want to talk about is things that I didn't expect when dating Koreans. And of course, I'm with my girlfriend now, so I'm going to keep it clean, not get too heavy here, so don't worry. One thing that I found to be very interesting is the difference in introducing your parents to your girlfriend or boyfriend. In the West, you could be dating someone for, you know, a few months, 2 or 3 months, and you could invite them over. And the four of you, your partner, and your parents can like play board games or card games or have a beer together. It's totally normal. Whereas in Korea, I'm coming to find that people wait till very late in the relationship, almost till they get married in many cases, to introduce their boyfriend or girlfriend to their parents. And I was actually talking to Yujung about this, my girlfriend, and she said, in the West, it's like, I really hope you like my parents. Whereas in Korea, it's more like, I really hope my parents like you. So I found this to be really interesting. And even though I've lived in Korea for over 6 years now, I definitely think, culturally speaking, I lean more towards the West in this regard. I find that you should find out early if your parents and your partner get along, because if they don't get along, that could create a lot of problems, and you kind of want to find these things out and hash them out, iron them out early on in the relationship. Anyway, this was just one big difference that I definitely have noticed while living here. Anyway, what do you guys think? Okay, we're walking to get some tea now. This next cafe is really interesting. It's got this brick interior. It almost looks like a volcano. There's brick in the middle, and then there are seats all around it, and it's really good for taking pictures. I think it's a popular cafe for that reason. So let's go in. I hope we can shoot video in there. Let's do it. Next thing I want to talk about is things that are becoming more and more socially acceptable as time goes on. Growing up, I definitely noticed that in school, the popular kids would never play like video games, or especially online games like RPGs. But these days, I noticed that as time is going on, like no matter if you're pretty, handsome, tall, short, whatever, popular in school, I guess, it's socially acceptable to say that I like online games, I like anime, I like cosplay, these sort of nerdy things that traditionally were not as socially acceptable. I do find though that, especially in the West, and I think here too in Korea, you can still probably get teased if you are, as they say, a weeaboo, or in Korean it's called otaku, which is like someone who is obsessed with Japanese culture to the extent where they'll learn the dances and wear kind of obscure costumes, watch anime that no one else really watches, very like underground stuff. It seems a little weird. And also people who are really into K-pop, which is a Koreaboo, is what we would call it in the US, I think they're also less socially accepted. I don't know why that is. I personally don't really care if someone is interested in K-pop, but still it's less socially acceptable and can be seen as quite nerdy to be interested in like all sorts of K-pop bands. Like I said, more power to you if you're into it, but I just am speaking about what I noticed amongst other young people. What do you guys think?
Who's this girl?
Hi.
So we're here in the park now, and I want to talk about my favorite season here in Korea. If I had to order the four seasons in terms of what I think is the most beautiful and pleasant time here in Korea, I would say number one, fall, with particular emphasis on September. September is beautiful during the day and nice and cool during the night. It's like that transition between summer and fall. You can literally do anything. Perfect time to go hiking the Han River. You can still kind of wear shorts during the day and do summery types of things. Okay, so after fall, I would have to say summer. Summer is pretty awesome, although summer gets really hot here in Korea, especially in like July. I've been living here for 6 years now, and I remember a few times where it's been so hot that you literally have to turn on the air conditioning when you're inside, and when you're outside, you just start sweating bullets. You're just sweating like crazy. It's not very pleasant. However, I do enjoy just wearing shorts, a shirt, going swimming, going to the beach. These things are awesome. So after that, I would have to say spring. Spring is pretty cool, but it's still a bit chilly here. And there's really bad yellow dust. The air pollution, at least from China and other factors, creates for not the best breathable environment. But that's okay, because it's better than my last and least favorite season, which is winter. Winter is really, really tough here in Korea, especially like January, February. December's all right, and at least you have like Christmas and New Year's to kind of hold you over. But I really feel like January and February are really rough. You have to have long padding. You pretty much stay inside. The heating is always on. It's expensive. But as long as you have good friends and fun things to do, it's a nice time to like catch up on reading, watch movies, play board games, which I love to do. So it's really not so bad, you know. Even if it's really cold, you can still do a lot of fun things. But anyway, that's my answer to what my favorite season is here in Korea. Hope you guys enjoyed, and what do you think? Oh, you're here. It's cold, hurry up and come in. I'm gonna give you guys a tour of my house, where I live, what I like to do here. So, let's start with the kitchen. Just take your shoes off and follow me this way. So, we're in the kitchen, and I actually spend a lot of time here. I love to cook. We have here the toaster oven. We have the stove. We have the sink. And we have the rice cooker. Actually, I have some sweet potatoes in there right now. We're gonna eat lunch after I film this. Actually, I use the rice cooker the most. We put sweet potatoes in there. Obviously, we put rice in there. I also use the stove a lot. We like to cook sweet potatoes, pasta, and definitely make a lot of rice. And when I say we, I mean myself and my girlfriend, who often comes over and eats with me. It's been very nice during this cold winter and this pandemic to have her company. Anyway, let's move to the living room. Come this way, please. So in the living room, we play so many games here. Just me and my girl, or me and my friends, or we just eat food here. This is one of my favorite games, Catan. It's really fun. Ah, let me show you a baby picture that I found when I was cleaning my house. What do you guys think? Does it look like me? Let me know in the comments. Ha 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 ha. Okay. So, yeah, I really like this living room because it's really big. You can have guests come over and sit down. And the sunlight kind of comes through when it's sunny out. It's a little bit cloudy today. You can see my weights in the back. Sometimes I like to, you know, do a little bit of the kettlebell exercises for my lower back and my legs. It's hard to go to the gym these days. Anyway, that is the living room. Follow me this way, if you would. So this is the studio. And in the studio, we have the computer where I play a lot of games, but mostly I do my editing here. Edit all the videos that you guys like to watch. I also do a lot of research here. I make plans. This is my workstation. So I also want to show you guys my new desk. I'm really happy that I got this. So because I do a lot of editing at home and I use the computer a lot, my back starts to hurt if I'm sitting down for too long. So I got this electric raising desk, or in Korean, it's called a motion desk. Let me show you. I'm quite tall, as you guys know. If I push this button, it will raise so that I can use the computer while standing. Oh yeah. Highly recommend this kind of table for anybody who does a lot of programming or editing at home. It's really good for your back and for your whole body to kind of stand up sometimes. You can't sit for too long. Sometimes I like to watch movies on the couch here. I'll just sit on the couch just like this. Ooh, feels good. And watch movies on the computer. I also play the guitar, so sometimes I like to just sit down and, you know, play the guitar, relieve some stress, get the creative energy going. So that's the studio. I spend a lot of time in here. Probably I spend the most time here in the studio working and just relaxing.
Let's go to the final room, which is the bedroom. Come and follow me. I'm gonna turn the light on for you guys so you can see better. Yeah, this is the bed, my closet. I have all my shirts in here, my clothing. And yeah, I have a queen-sized bed. It's very comfortable. I'm quite tall, as you guys probably can guess, so I need a bigger bed. But yeah, the size of the room is absolutely perfect, and I love it. Right now, it's quite cold because it's January. It's winter time. So we use this water heater, and it heats up water in this container and puts it here under my bed. And so when we're sleeping, the water heater really warms us up. It saves a lot of money on the heating, because heating is really expensive in a little bit of a bigger place like this. Yeah, so come just take a quick look, see what it looks like. This is my cabinet. I have a lot of supplements in there, vitamins, this kind of stuff. That's my air purifier. You can see it has a little bit of dust because I haven't really been using it lately. But yeah, this is my bedroom. That's it. You know what? I'm gonna give you guys a bonus room. Follow me this way. This is the bathroom. I really like the location of the bathroom because it's very convenient. It's right next to the living room. So it's not far for any room to come here. It's kind of in the middle. We keep it pretty clean. Obviously, we shower in here. We brush our teeth. My girlfriend has a lot of makeup here. It's almost like an Olive Young store here. There's so much makeup. But yeah, I think it's perfect for us. So that's the bathroom. All right, guys. So what do you think of my house? Did you like it?
Quiz time. What room does Sean spend the most time in? A, the bedroom. B, the studio. C, the kitchen. Sean spends the most time in the studio. How does Sean keep his bed warm? A, an electric heater. B, hot packs. C, water heater. Sean keeps his bed warm with a water heater. Why does Sean use an electric raising desk? A, to stand up and stretch his legs and back. B, because it looks cool. C, because it was cheap. Sean uses an electric raising desk to stretch his legs and back while working. What does Sean not do in the living room? A, play board games. B, eat. C, edit videos. Sean does not edit videos in the living room.
Do you like these kind of videos? Let me know in the comments. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. I'm Sean, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.